Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to our third and last symposium here at the Australian Museum. I would like to welcome Uncle Charles Madden, Gadigal Elder, to do the welcome to country.
Good, thank you. Good morning, folks. My name is Charles Madden, but known around the inner city as Chicka. That's a nickname that I got many, many years ago going to Redfern Public School, which is now NCIE, the National Centre for Indigenous Excellence. Folks, I'm from Gadigal land, Aboriginal land. That's the land we're on at the moment. For many, many years, I've been involved with different Aboriginal organisations in and around the city. I've been a director with the Aboriginal Medical Service at Redfern for over 40 years. Also a director with the Redfern Aboriginal Housing Company, Aboriginal Hostels Australia, and the Metropolitan Local Aboriginal Land Council, where I am still a very active member. I've got to mention it, folks. Also a life member of the Redfern All Blacks Rugby League Football Club. Folks, for many, many years I've lived and worked in and around the inner city of Sydney. I'd like to take this opportunity this morning to extend a warm and sincere welcome to any of my Aboriginal brothers and sisters, non-Aboriginal brothers and sisters who may have travelled here onto Gadigal land. If you have any brothers and sisters from the Torres Strait or further afar across the seas, welcome. Welcome to Gadigal land. The Gadigal clan is one of 29 that makes up the Eora Nation. The Eora Nation is bordered by three distinctive landmarks. We have the Hawkesbury River to the north, Nepean to the west, and the Georges River to the south. Those three rivers form the boundaries of the Eora Nation. Folks, if you've travelled across this great city of ours this morning, a state or this great country, welcome. Welcome to Gadigal land. Enjoy your stay. Have a safe and trouble-free trip home. Once again, welcome, welcome, welcome. Thank you. Enjoy the morning.
Thank you, Uncle Charles, for your very warm welcome. For me it has been a great privilege to work with Jonathan. I worked with many artists in the past, but Jonathan is very different. His dedication, his knowledge of his ancestors and country has been a great privilege to me. And although I lived in Australia for over 60 years now, it has opened my eyes to a part of Australia that I have never known before. So for that, Jonathan, thank you very much. I also learned that while obviously I can't welcome to country, I can, like all of you, can acknowledge country, which was also something very new to me. So I would like to acknowledge this beautiful country that for the last 200 years has been called Sydney. But for thousands of preceding years, the serene magnificence of its trees, its hills, its rivers and the sea has been celebrated by local Aboriginal languages. I would also like to acknowledge the Gadigal people of the Eora Nation who for countless generations were the custodians of this land. and we are fortunate that we can share their stories with us. Thank you. Thank you for attending the last of these three symposia. Jonathan's project, Barrangal Dyara, Skin and Bones, opens in 6 weeks from today at the Royal Botanical Gardens, and they have been a great partner enabling us to do this project. Just a bit of diversion. When in 2015, it looked like Jonathan would be announced as the winner of our competition for an artist to come up with a very good idea, I thought I better do something and talk to the Botanic Gardens, as I can't really ambush them with the idea that we want to do, announce a project in the gardens without their permission. And I was petrified, because previously we had just a little bit to do with the gardens, and they were very difficult. So I made an appointment with the new director, Kim Ellis, who is here with us today, thinking, how will I break the news that we want to do an enormous contemporary art project in the garden? And so, with my best Hungarian, I tried to sort of gently ease him into it. But to my great relief, Kim, from the beginning, was most enthusiastic about the project and has been a great partner for us. Kim, thank you very much. Barrangal Dyara, Skin and Bones has turned out to be much more than an art project. It's really a multi-dimensional cultural event that highlights, through Aboriginal perspective, the suffering that the Southeast Aboriginal community suffered through the loss of its cultural objects by the fire of the Garden Palace in 1882. Each of the three symposia, the first in May at the State Library, the second at the Art Gallery, and this final one, has been presented with a major cultural organization that shares a profound history with the Garden Palace. Today, thank you very much to the Australian Museum, to Director Kim McKay, who is with us, for partnering with us to explore the generative effect of the fire that consumed the Garden Palace, and to celebrate the resilience of the many cultures that it's impacted. Today we get a sense of how communities can heal and find new ways to strive after the catastrophe. Many thanks to Laura McBride and Tasha Lamb for their enormous and sustained effort to make today's a success. Thank you, Laura. Thank you, Tasha. I would like to thank all our distinguished presenters. Look forward to a very interesting day. Thank you to all the staff of our small organization, and especially the education team headed by Sue Saxon. Thank you. Each of the three symposia will be live streamed, and it'll be on throughout the year. We will have an extensive catalog, which we will launch on the 22nd of September, the day that the palace burned down. And I just heard 5 minutes ago that famous author David Malouf agreed to launch the publication. So that's great news. I would now like to ask Museum Director Kim McKay and Creative Producer Laura McBride to open the symposium. Thank you very much for coming.
Thanks so much, John, and welcome everyone to the Australian Museum this morning. I too would like to acknowledge the traditional owners of the land that we're gathered on this morning, the Gadigal people of the Eora Nation, and pay my deep respects to Elders past and present, and thank you, Uncle Chica, for coming out this morning to be with us yet again. You're a regular visitor to the Australian Museum. It's wonderful to have you here yet again. I'd also like to extend that welcome to other Indigenous and Torres Strait Islander people who are here with us this morning. Of course, I always say that it's so important that we acknowledge country at the Australian Museum, as we are the custodians of one of the most significant Indigenous collections in the nation. Of course, sadly, that collection is really representative of other parts of Australia, as we lost most of the Sydney collection in the fire at the Garden Palace. I just want to say what a privilege it is to have all of you here today for a day of listening and learning. And I want to thank John Kaldor and Jonathan Jones and Ross Gibson for the huge opportunity to be part of this, because not only are you helping us understand more about certainly the Sydney Indigenous history, but you've also incidentally done something, which is bringing the cultural institutions and the gardens, and I want to acknowledge my fellow director Kim Ellis from the gardens here today, but bringing us together as well through this story and through this experience. And that's really very important, because we do have a shared history in this town. I also do want to acknowledge our tremendous staff here at the museum. We're so fortunate. We've got a wonderful cultural team here representing Indigenous Australia and also the Pacific communities. Stephen Alderton, who is here today, heads up our cultural collections team and our public performance and exhibitions team. But, you know, leaders like Laura and Tash and all of you from the Australian Museum, thank you. They're a wonderful team here. They go beyond what you would anticipate staff would do to make things very special. And Jonathan, you're part of our family too, really. I mean, today, if you haven't been inside yet, in Bayalanura, which is one of our two Indigenous galleries just off to my right-hand side here, Jonathan has created the most extraordinary shield installation. These are Indigenous shields from right across different parts of Australia, but it is an incredibly beautiful installation, as you would expect from Jonathan. But more than that, it communicates so much about Indigenous history and our collection. So it's wonderful that you could do that work with us, and we hope you'll be doing many more things with us in the future as well. Now, the Australian Museum turns 190 years old next year. Of course, the Gardens is 200 this year. The Botanic Gardens is the oldest scientific research organisation in Australia. We're the second oldest as such. And we have all sorts of activities planned next year. We've been on this site on the corner of College and William Street since 1845. The building first started being constructed, the first of the 10 buildings on site here. And was finished in around 1850. So it used to be, immediately before they built it, a convict garden. But of course it had a very long history before that. This museum, unfortunately, hasn't always had a very proud history of working with our Indigenous people. The Australian Museum, of course, at that time was deeply entrenched in our colonial history. Reflected somewhat, I guess, in the grand sandstone buildings that make up the museum. Back in the 1800s, we sent our native animals off to Europe for further study. We didn't think we could do that properly here. It wasn't actually until a German director of the museum, Gerard Kreft, in the 1860s said, no, we have to keep them here and study our local wildlife. In fact, Australia becomes sort of the flavour of the month at that time, and even Napoleon gave Josephine two kangaroos to as a gift, which, you know, in paintings we see them portrayed hopping around their grand, you know, French chateau in the garden. Of course, they didn't survive the French winter. And of course, at the time we also collected the cultural treasures of Sydney's Indigenous people. And of course, most of those, as I said earlier, burned down in the fire in 1882. And we only have a few photographs left to show us the depth of that loss. Now today we are striving here at the museum to build much better and deeper relationships with our Indigenous Australians. We've been a leader in Indigenous repatriation particularly through the work of Phil Gordon here at the Australian Museum. And we're committed to growing our Indigenous staff here at the museum, not just so that they work just in Indigenous culture here, but they work right across all of the disciplines at the museum. And while we have our Reconciliation Action Plan, we're now starting a much bigger project to have a very widespread Indigenous strategy and cultural awareness training for all of our staff here. Particularly, we have a master plan. As you know, the state government has said the cultural institutions may all get some funding for redevelopment, which we desperately need here. We've called our master plan Barabawari Muru, which in the Sydney language literally sort of translates as future path, and it is our future path. As part of that master plan, we want to create here an Indigenous and Pacific Cultural Research Centre that will become known throughout the world. You know, I've had a long-held dream, which was to see Sydney Harbour before white settlement. And that's because I worked on the clean-up of Sydney Harbour for a long time. And it's one of the most special places in the world. It has a remarkable energy to it. It's why whales used to come in here all the time and carve, until we drove them away with the whaling industry. It's a very, very special waterway. So I had this long-held belief, and when I came here to the museum, I was so thrilled and amazed to see this very short film clip that we have on the floor here in one of our Indigenous galleries, which through the use of CG animation takes us back to what Sydney Harbour looked like before white settlement. I urge you today to go in there and try and spend some time. It only takes about 5 minutes to watch that clip. But what it shows is this most beautiful and remarkable location. As John said, with the extraordinary trees and topography around the harbour. And you see these little spot fires on the headlands. And the filmmakers have put the language and the chatter of local communities around it. And you get a sense of what this place must have been like, this very special place that now I feel so privileged to live in. And I'm sure all of you do too. We're very fortunate to be living in Australia. We have a long way to go to make it better, as we've seen in recent weeks in the news. But I know that with the goodwill, but it's going to take more than that, than goodwill and good intention. It's going to take fast commitment from every Australian to make Australia a much better place for us, for all of us, and especially for to pay the correct level of respect and status to our Indigenous people. So I know today I'm so excited. I'm so excited to be able to listen to our fantastic speakers and to learn from them today. And that's how we will progress things, to gain greater understanding. So John and your team, thank you so much for hosting this. And Jonathan, thank you so much for bringing everything that you bring to our cultural institutions and to this city, because we are deeply richer for it. And I know after today, we're going to be even richer. So with that, it's my great pleasure to welcome one of our Indigenous staff, Laura McBride, who has worked so hard, along with Tasha Kent, to bring today to you. Please welcome Laura.
Good morning. My name's Laura McBride, and I'm a Welwan woman and creative producer here at the Australian Museum. Thank you, Uncle Chika, for your welcome today, and I too would like to acknowledge the Gadigal people whose land we meet on today. For me, the theme of this symposium, loss and resilience, is a particularly relevant topic to consider within a natural history museum. Besides being interesting, as Kim has already stated, these discussions could help guide us in the best practice regarding our Aboriginal collections. I was hoping you could consider two things when listening to the talks today. The first is regarding loss for Aboriginal people and the relationships we have with collecting and public institutions. Loss to Aboriginal people is multifaceted. Today we are not just considering the loss of countless early objects in the Garden Palace fire or the thousands of objects that have been taken since this time, but the massive loss of Aboriginal people's freedom to be able to practice our own culture for many, many years. Although issues regarding Aboriginal people today are complex, we now know that the strength of culture and identity is a determining factor in improving Aboriginal socioeconomic circumstances. Hence, collecting and public institutions that hold cultural material and knowledge have become much more significant today. The way Aboriginal people relate to and utilise such places is different to their other visitors. The second consideration is more specifically related to museums. Museums are generally sites of authority regarding facts. Natural history museums in particular are sites of authority on science, nature, and Indigenous peoples. They have, since their inception, controlled how we are represented and therefore how audiences interpret us. When looking at the history of exhibitions on Indigenous Australians, how we have been represented in them is a good reflection of how we have been treated in society at those times by governments, their substantive policies, and by our fellow non-Indigenous Australians. This view of museums held by the public means that we can be quite powerful players in the conversations regarding Aboriginal Australia. We could potentially, over time, help mitigate stereotypes and assumptions that hold power over how we are viewed as individuals and how we are viewed as communities, and then ultimately how we are treated by others. To ensure this is done accurately, and this has also just been mentioned by Kim, museums should care for, display, and interpret objects in partnership and collaboration with those of which it's representing. We have started to move in this direction at the Australian Museum. In late 2014, we launched Gadigal, Sea Country. This was the first exhibition about Indigenous Australian people and culture told from an Indigenous perspective. It incorporates Aboriginal language, knowledge, and worldview in the interpretation of the content. The exhibition is one of two located next door, the other being Bayala Nura. We invite you to take a look at these over the lunch break. And Rebecca Fisher, one of our great collection officers that works in our Aboriginal collections, will also be in the gallery over the lunch break. And today we have brought out some special objects from our collection that are not normally seen by the public just for you today. I'd like to thank Jonathan and Kaldor, John and your team for undertaking barrangal dyara and the accompanying spot fires. Thanks to my executive leadership team, Kim and Stephen, two who are here today, for hosting the project at Australia's first and best Natural History Museum. Thanks to Tasha. I want to thank Tasha, who's my sidekick and my partner in culture here at the Australian Museum, and you'll be hearing from Tasha a little bit later. And lastly, I'd like to thank all of you that came here today, because you're really vital component of us having these discussions and these conversations around this content. So thank you and welcome.
Yirudu Marang, Mujigilang, Hiwindi Jonathan Jones, Baladu Radri Bu Gimilore Bu Gibibu, Ngati Nguna, Ngijamala Mayangalang, Nurumbangu Gadigobu Ioribu. And as always, I'd like to make a special welcome and thank you to Uncle Chika, who always makes us feel really special on his beautiful country, and whose ongoing support has been an amazing inspiration for this project. Obviously this morning too, I'd like to pick up on some thanks. These massive projects sort of don't happen by themselves. Obviously I'd like to thank Kim and all the team here at the Australian Museum, including Stephen, Laura, Tash, Rebecca, And of course, Phil Gordon, who's not here. Phil, of course, was an extraordinary inspiration for this project, which I'll explain a little later on. And also I'd like to acknowledge Robin Quiggan, who is not here either, but who is on the Board of Trustees, is a really important Wiradjuri woman who has also been, I guess, working behind the scenes a lot on supporting this institution. Obviously, I'd like to thank John and the team, and both John and myself would really like to pay our respects and gratitude to Ross Gibson, who helped design and curate this project, these symposiums, but who isn't able to be here with us. And we'd also like to thank our Indigenous advisors as well. So we've had an amazing group of people who have been supporting us and helping us navigate a whole bunch of issues, including Hetty Perkins, who'll be here with us today, Christine Evans, Jason Glanville, Michael McDaniel, and Uncle Chica. So as mentioned, today is the third and final symposium connected to the art project Barrangal Dyara, which opens on the 17th of September, only 42 days away. We're not stressed. Being the final symposium, I'd really like to acknowledge all of you who have come with us on this journey. And this is really, really important because, in fact, John and I were struck, once we started researching this project, John and I were both really struck with how much was unknown and how much knowledge there was around this building and around this story. And, you know, these symposiums are really a way of opening up that knowledge that we've found and opening up the ideas that we were lucky enough to sort of work with and make them public. And also, it will really help provide a context. What we're trying to do is lay the track work for the exhibition that you will see on site. So this is really about getting our ideas out there. As you can imagine, it's not that easy making an artwork about a project, about a story that no one knows. So this is really about building up that knowledge around that story. I'm already on. There we go. So my introduction will really start to cover many of the ideas raised in some of the previous symposiums, but hopefully start to flesh out and take us to the final level of our understanding around the story. As you know, Barrangal Dyara really looks at the story of the Garden Palace. And more importantly, I guess, the project really makes us think about how we remember things, how we remember places, how cultural ideas are locked within our landscape. And of course, over today we're going to have a whole series of extraordinary people help navigate us through these very complex issues of memory and sight and how things are actually work within our narrative. As we know, that the building itself, in fact, was part of, I guess, an extraordinary kind of idea around nation building. And part of that nation building really was how Aboriginal people and how Aboriginal material fitted within that national story. And as raised today, some of the real issues that we're working with is still unpicking how Aboriginal people and where Aboriginal stories fit within our national identity. This is, of course, how Aboriginal culture was featured in the international exhibition in the Garden Palace. However, as we all know, in the wee hours of Friday, the 22nd of September 1882, the entire building and its contents was lost. And of course, it's this idea of the fire and rekindling this fire, rekindling this knowledge that this symposium takes its name after. And as discussed before, these three symposiums are really occurring in collaboration with those institutions. As we know, as we were discussing already this morning, the Australian Museum is the oldest museum in Australia. Interestingly enough, it was first established in 1821 and in fact was located in the foyer of the Colonial Secretary's building on Macquarie Street. Of course, the sort of the seat of power, if you like, for the colony. And then, of course, it moved here to this site, as Kim mentioned. And of course, one of the other sort of tangible connections between the Garden Palace and the Australian Museum is that it was authored by the same architect. James Barnett, of course, was the author of that story. Of course, within that building, when it was burning, as you're seeing here, was not only just the collections from the Australian Museum of what was known as the ethnographic collections, and I'd also like to acknowledge today that it wasn't just an extraordinary loss for Aboriginal people, it was an extraordinary loss for groups right across the Pacific. And in addition to that, there was also enormous records lost on that day as well, including, and I never get this word, the Linnaean collection of scientific specimens. For some reason, I can never get my word or my mouth around that word. And so today, what we're really here to talk about is what this loss means to us. How do we come to terms with this loss? How do we remember this loss? And how do we move forward with this loss, knowing about this loss? So I thought today a really good way of starting the conversations off, thinking about Sydney as a site of resilience, because in so many ways this is seen as the end of the story. This is seen almost as the full stop in the narrative. But in fact, Sydney is an extraordinarily resilient city. It's a site that has continued to bounce back. And I thought today we might take an opportunity to think about that in a really special way. And I might invite Uncle Chicka up just to have a bit of a yarn about a special story, which I think might help explain this idea of Sydney being a sort of special sort of site of resilience. Okay, so as you mentioned, and many of you know Uncle Chicka, and Uncle Chicka even mentioned in your welcome that, of course, he was working on the Redfern Medical Service for 40 years. And last time I checked, that's the oldest membership. You've been on there the longest than anyone. Is that right?
Sol's been there for a while, but I think I had the longest
continued
service,
right.
Yeah.
And I guess what I was wondering if you could tell us a special story today, because the medical service itself, of course, is designed around supporting Aboriginal health, but the medical service does a lot more than just health. And one of the key stories that I know you and Nanny Lil have always told us is about Aboriginal Fashion Week and how that started. Are you able to tell us a little bit about that?
Yes, well, we had a program, different programs going at the medical service. And in the early days, my wife worked up there. She was with the, more or less with the nutrition program that they had going there. And we had a lot of... She was with the elders. They had different classes. They'd come in to pick them up from La Perouse and around Redfern and the inner city. And they were talking one day and they thought, well, we should do something for the younger generation. And they says, we should start a class up and have a deportment class. We'll get in touch with June Daly Watkins in the city and we'll take the children down there and June will teach them deportment. So that happened, and when they finished, they said to June Daly Watkins, they says, do you think any of the girls would make good models? And she said, June Daly said, oh, no, I don't think so. They're not tall enough. They're a little bit wide. But they've got beautiful ankles. And when they went back to the medical service, they're talking to Naomi Mays, the CEO, and they were a little bit upset about it. They said, well, I think we should run our own fashion parade. It doesn't matter what size the girls are or what they look like, we'll just put them in the fashion show, and it'll make they finish the deportment and it'll make them feel good. So they said, Okay, we'll do that. So the Aboriginal dance theatre had a Filipino lady down there that was used to teach them dancing, so they had a talk with her, and she says, she'll put the girls through their paces. So the beauty of it was, they never just got the girls from around Redfern, they got them from La Perouse and out west, had a really good collection of the young women and brought them in from all over Sydney. We had a catwalk marked out upstairs in the medical service, just tape on the floor and that, so that's where they started training them. They had three fashion designers at the time. They had Bronwyn Bancroft, Femi Bostock, and a young lad from Newcastle. They were going to design the clothes. They booked it out the airport Hilton, and then they got all the music put together. It was all Aboriginal themes, you know, that they booked the Hilton out, and they said, we might get about 300 or 400 people here. I think they had about 600 that night, wall to wall. It was such a raging success, so the next year they said, well, the airport Hilton's too small, we'll have to go to the roundhouse out at the uni. So the next year went out there, and they had about 1,000 people there that night. And one of the photographers, he was a French photographer, was in the audience. He took some photos. And about a week after the fashion parade, he showed his photos to a French journalist. She was from the Le Mode newspaper in Paris that came out. And we had a video of it, the parade. She liked it, so she took it back to Paris. And in the when she took it back there, she showed it to the people at Gallery Lafayette, that's the other big department store. Warper and Tomps, that's the name of it, yeah. Showed them, and every year they had one complete floor decked out for a country around the world to display all their products and wares. And the year coming up was the 1987, was the Australian government had the floor booked out for it. So they said, well, would you like to bring the fashion parade over to Paris? And they said, yes, well, that'd be great. All the girls and the boys were excited. Millie Bronwyn and the other guy who designed all the clothes for the models, they got busy. And then we had a couple of guys, and my son was involved with it, doing the music for the fashion parade. And we run different fundraising to take the girls and the boys over there to Paris. I think there was about 9 models altogether. And we had a lot of the parents and that, plus the Lucy, our coordinator with the models. And everything got really intense coming up to it. Qantas was very good. They gave us, they said, we can't give you any money or free flights, but we'll give you a family pass if you want to raffle it to go over to LA to Disneyland. So that was good. That made us a lot of money. We got the models all together, and the show was good. I went over to Paris, and the lady from the newspaper over there met us, and everything was laid on really great. It was well looked after. And we went to Orpher and Thompson, the big department store, and all the bosses of the organisation, they were that impressed with it. They had a group of models from Eastern Suburbs TAFE that was going over there to model, do a fashion parade too. So they were before us, but when they seen the Aboriginal fashion parade, they pulled them off and put us in front of them. And rather doing it down on that level, if you've ever been to Printemps in Paris, on the top floor they've got a huge glass dome, and there's eateries all around the wall, and they have a special catwalk for all the French top models to come out. It's on a big circle at the end of it. They get about 400 to 500 people in there every day just to sit down for food and that and watch whatever's going on. So they moved us upstairs with that. When we had a didge player with us, he'd come out and he'd walk through and play the didge, then the models had all come out. And they were totally different to what you see walking down the catwalk now. They'd come down, they'd spin around, because this lady from the Philippines taught them how to use their hands and different things, and it looked really good, and the clothes were really sensational, a lot of Aboriginal designs on them, and they done two shows a day for about nearly 2 weeks, I think. And what's her name? Sol, Blair and Naomi come over there, and they had to go to Geneva for a conference. But at the time, got Whitlam was in Paris too, working. And they went to see him before they went up to Geneva, and it was Goff who said to them, he said, "Do you know what yous have done here today?" They says, "No, what's that?" He says, "The first cricket team to ever tour Paris, to tour England, was an Aboriginal cricket team, and they were from Melbourne." He said, "You know what?" He said, "The first group of Aboriginals to parade fashion in Paris were Aboriginal, and that's you, Mob." So that was something that happened there that we weren't expecting, which is good. It was never ever talked about. We only had a little write-up in the paper until the Paris thing happened, and it was really big. So that's something positive that's come out of the AMS at Redfern and Redfern itself. So it was great to be a part of it.
You know, that's great. I think it just is one of those stories that really talks about Sydney being a really resilient place. But also that idea that, I guess, the resilience that we do isn't always, isn't always something like like fashion, I guess, isn't really this idea and girls getting out. But a lot of those young women went on and got amazing jobs. A lot of them went got Qantas jobs and were stewardesses in the air.
Oh, yes. When they came back, Qantas, who helped us before we went over, they were out at the fashion parade we put on when we come back to Sydney, out at the roundhouse. And they were there, the Qantas, and they asked us, we had a meeting with them in town, they says, "How come we haven't, no Aboriginals have applied to fly with Qantas?" I said, "My daughter put an application in for a job there, and she's been knocked back." They said, "Will you tell her to reapply?" She was one of the models.
Yeah.
So she she only had a week to go before she turned 21. I don't think they were putting them on till they were 24 at the time. But they put her on, she was the youngest, I think one of the youngest flight attendants. They put her on there, and that was nearly 30 years ago. She's still there, and she's a customer service manager now. Flies, flew long haul for about 14 years, and then got married, started the family. Now she flies short all out of Brisbane, around.
Yeah, that's great. I think you can kind of get the idea that, yeah, Sydney's been an extraordinary place. You know, this country has kind of created a whole bunch of ideas and really kind of strengthened the Aboriginal community from so many different angles.
Well, out of all those models that went away, I think about four of them end up working with Qantas and one with Ansett until they, what's the name?
Failed.
And
they failed,
eh? Yeah. No, it's, okay. It was a good stepping stone for all the kids from Redfern.
Right.
I just mention a little story here about over in Paris. When Sol and Naomi come over there on their way to Geneva, all the models are only all young. And there was one certain song that was part of the fashion parade. They'd all be out there peeping around the curtains looking, and they'd say, young Tamara, she was only 15 at the time, she was our youngest model, that's Sol's daughter. They'd all look and they'd say, yeah, he's sitting right up the front. That'd be Sol sitting there. Then they'd start, she'd be waiting there, then she'd walk out and the music would start. It was all Aboriginal theme music. The first part of the song would be Black Fella. And she'd point straight at her father. Black fella and white fella. And he'd be sitting there, you could see his lips going. Cursed her. The next parade, he was up the back. All the kids would get him. Yeah, he's up. Come out then, black fella, she'd point at him up there. The third time he was hiding in the crowd, right? Poor old Sol, I always have a go at him that. You mentioned that song, Black Fella, White Fella. Doesn't matter what your colour, she'd stir him up with it.
Thanks so much. Now, sorry, I know we're running late already, and I was hoping that wouldn't happen, but I'll promise to get us back on track, and maybe notes aren't helping. I guess what I wanted to quickly pick up on, obviously, is this, like, storytelling is really important. Ideas of thinking about country, thinking about places in different ways is really, really important. And one of the things that I know that I've been introducing to us over the course of this symposium is perhaps thinking about how the stories of our elders. And all too often, whenever you have a story told to you, you've got to work hard and think about the meaning and understand what you're being told. And I'm very lucky where my family's from in Bathurst. I've got a group of elders out there who often use birds to tell stories. So some of you might remember the very first symposium that we launched at the State Library was about landscape and language. And some of you will remember that I raised the notion that, of course, our native parrots, our birds that were here in Sydney, were often cursed. They were cursed and hunted. And people hated the sound of their voice. And in fact, what I found really interesting was, of course, this was the same with Aboriginal languages. Aboriginal languages were not welcome. But slowly, over time, we've come to love our birds. In fact, these are some birds at the Botanic Gardens. And they're part of our vernacular now. They're part of our identity. In fact, when you hear birds sing, it kind of makes you feel really good about being here. And in a way, I wanted us to think about those parrots reminding us about our Aboriginal languages and the slow sort of awakening to Aboriginal languages that we're having. Our last symposium, I showed you this little fella, which was Bula Nurum, which is a little bowerbird, a spotted bowerbird from central New South Wales. He's a little fella who makes collections. As we've talked about this morning, collections for Aboriginal people are uncomfortable things. Collections, for the most part, have not worked in our favour. Collections have often been made about us and not for us. And so as an Aboriginal person, I've often been awkward around the notion of how one collects culture. What does that mean? What does that look like? Who does it service? And who's empowered by that process? But this little fella reminded me, of course, that collections are okay. Collections can be good. Collections are part of life. Building up stories, building up narratives, making places is part of what we do. And today, I wanted to introduce us to our third and final feathered friend that I wanted us to think about in terms of how to think about these stories that we're presenting to you. And of course, today, this notion of loss and resilience. I was very keen to talk about this, the superb lyrebird, or Jugala, as we call him in Wiradjuri. This bird, of course, is an extraordinary creature. We all probably know his renditions in sound. I was going to play a little film, but I think I'll skip the film because we've all heard him sing, and he's an extraordinary songbird. But what was interesting, of course, about this bird is that, like a lot of our treasures, a lot of Australia's treasures that Aboriginal communities hold very, very dear, they're very, very old. And in fact, this institution was part of that story of unpicking the history that, in fact, these songbirds are 40 million years old. There's bird fossils of the lyrebird's ancestors in this building that were collected up at Riversley in Queensland that date this bird to 40,000 years. And in fact, like Kim was saying, this bird very skillfully, through the notion of science, started to remind us that not everything good and not everything great necessarily has to come from the Northern Hemisphere. That in fact, we shouldn't have been sending our animals away. Our animals belonged here and there's a lot of work to be done here. And so this little bird, of course, and some of you have probably read Tim Lowe's book, was part of the story about how Australia, of course, is the originator of songbirds. Australia's gift to the world was song through the birds. And it's the ancestor of this little fella that gave the world that song. The other idea that I wanted us to raise with this little fella is he makes us think about memory in a very special way. Because for a long time, his feathers were hunted, his back tail feathers, those superb, beautiful tail feathers. They were hunted. You could go walk down the streets of Melbourne and Sydney and buy them. People would decorate their house with them. In the 1930s, there was such a concern around their endangered, pushing them to the brink, that I think a group of 20 birds were taken, captured, and taken down to Tasmania. They don't belong in Tasmania, they were never there, but they were dropped in Tasmania as kind of a little preservation idea. Today that number's swollen to, they think, almost 8,000 birds. But what's interesting about those birds is their memory, because these birds, as we know, recall the songs of other birds and repeat other birds. And when we go to Tasmania, we can hear these birds, we can hear lyrebirds singing the songs of birds that aren't from Tasmania, like the whipbird isn't in Tasmania. And today you can go to Tasmania and you can hear a whipbird, but it's not from a whipbird, it's from one of the ancestors of the birds that were dropped off at that island. So these birds can remember things that they never saw, that they don't have any memory of, physical memory of, but it's something genetically within them that they remember. They remember the songs of their parents, they remember the songs of their grandparents. And in fact, this notion of genetically remembering something that you can't see is, of course, at the very heart of this project. The idea that you can think about something, that you can recall something, you can make a song and a dance about something that isn't there, is very much at the core of this project. And then there's a third little story with this fellow, which I thought was quite interesting as well, that I wanted us to become aware of, which is deeply embedded with the Garden Palace, which is, of course, these little fellows, these little guys are deeply connected to fire. And I'll just bring up some of these facts. But a group of researchers down in the hills of Victoria, in fact, were working with the lyrebird. And after the Black Saturday fires of 2000, I think it was 2000. Sorry, everyone. Back in the Black Saturday fires, God, I've really jumped. This is good. We're moving through. Back in the Black Saturday fires of 2009, they came back to find their birds, thinking that the research that they'd been doing on these birds would be over, that those little birds wouldn't be there. But in fact, what they found was extraordinary. They found that, in fact, where their lyrebirds were, where there were high density of lyrebirds, the fire had stopped. And they tried to work out what it was. And of course, these fellas, and you can see they've got big, long legs, big feet, they're ground birds, and they spend all day moving the bush, digging up the bush, digging up the landscape, turning over the soil, finding grubs, finding what they need. And through that process of digging up the ground, they're in fact composting the ground. And what they're doing is making huge fire breaks. And so the valleys where they lived hadn't been touched. And the researchers have now been working that in fact these little birds turn over 200 tonnes per hectare per year. An extraordinary amount of leaf litter moving over and causing enormous fire breaks. And so I guess I was interested in this bird because he not only connects us with fire, he not only connects us with our ancestry, but he also connects us with this idea of how we remember things. And I think that's something really important that in fact is something that I think is at the very heart of this project. I wanted today to start off with a reading, and today's reading is, of course, we've been lucky enough to have Russell Smith read for us from historical texts for every symposium. But today's symposium, I wanted the reading to go first because I think it will line up some of the ideas that we've raised. And I'd like to stress that this is a historical text. This is a word-for-word historical text from the Sydney Morning Herald in 1879. And it's a text that is uncomfortable for Aboriginal people to hear, but it's a text that I think we probably, it really starts to set the day and gets us thinking about the story. Mm-hmm.